హక్కులేని హ్యూమన్ రైట్స్ ఎక్కడ సార్? మహిళల హక్కులే మానవ హక్కులు. ఇది ఇది అందరూ గమనించాల్సిన అవసరం ఉంది. ఎక్కడైతే మహిళ రక్షించబడుతుందో, ఎక్కడైతే మహిళ గౌరవించబడుతుందో, ఎక్కడైతే మహిళ ప్రొటెక్ట్ చేయవలసి పడుతుందో, ఆ సమాజమే అభివృద్ధి చెందుతుంది సార్. అందరూ చెప్తా ఉంటారు మరి ఎక్కడ మహిళల్ని మనం గౌరవంగా చూస్తామని. నిజమే ప్రభుత్వాలు చేస్తున్నాయి, కానీ ప్రభుత్వాలు చేసిన ఫలితాలు ప్రజలకి అందటం లేదు. ఈ ప్రజలకి అందాలి అంటే, ఈ చట్టాల పట్ల ఉండాలి అంటే తప్పనిసరిగా ఈ ఏమైతే మార్పులు జరుగుతున్నాయో, హ్యూమన్ రైట్స్ కమిషన్ని, స్టేట్ హ్యూమన్ రైట్స్ కమిషన్ని మార్పు చేస్తూ ఉన్నారో, వాటికి ఫుల్గా స్ట్రెంత్ ఇవ్వాలి సార్. వాటిని బలోపేతం చేయాలి. ఆ కమిషన్ పూర్తిగా చేయాల్సిన అవసరం ఉంది. కాబట్టి
ధన్యవాదాలు సభాపతి మహోదయ.
ప్లీజ్ ఫినిష్ ప్లీజ్ ప్లీజ్ కన్క్లూడ్.
ఈ ఏమైతే మార్పులు చేస్తున్నారో మరొక్కసారి నేను వెల్కమ్ చేస్తూ, ఈ కమిషన్ ఇండిపెండెంట్ గా పనిచేసే విధంగా, కట్టుదిట్టంగా పనిచేసే విధంగా, అదేవిధంగా మానవ హక్కులను రక్షించే విధంగా, మహిళల హక్కులను రక్షించే విధంగా మంచి ఈ ఈ హ్యూమన్ రైట్స్ కమిషన్ ద్వారా మానవాళికి మేలు జరిగే విధంగా, ఈ మార్పులు మేలు జరిగే విధంగా ఉండాలని, ఇంకా కట్టుదిట్టమైన చట్టాలు తేవాలని కోరుతూ థ్యాంక్ యూ సార్.
ధన్యవాదాలు సభాపతి మహోదయ్. ద ప్రొటెక్షన్ ఆఫ్ హ్యూమన్ రైట్స్ అమెండ్మెంట్ బిల్ 2019, ఇస్ బిల్ కా సమర్థన్ కర్నే కే లియే మై యహాన్ ఖడా హూం. సభాపతి మహోదయ్, దునియాకే సబ్సే బడే లోకశాహీ ప్రధాన్ అప్నే దేశ్ కే సంవిధాన్ నే దేశ్ కే సారే వర్గ కే హిత్ కా ప్రావధాన్ అచ్చీ తరహ సే కియా హై. ఖాస్ కర్కే అప్నే దేశ్ కే సారే జో మానవ్ హై, సజీవ ప్రాణి హై, ఇన్కే భీ ఇన్కే హక్ కా సంరక్షణ కైసా హో ఔర్ సంరక్షణ కే లియే క్యా క్యా ప్రావధాన్ కర్నే హై, ఇస్కా పూరీ తరికే సే ధ్యాన్ अपने संविधान ने अच्छी तरह से दिए है. और इसीलिए 1993 में मानवाधिकार आयोग का स्थापना इस देश में हुआ, और उसके बाद लाखों की संख्या से इस मानवाधिकार आयोग के पास जो जो मामले दर्ज हुए, चाहे वो राष्ट्रीय मानवाधिकार हो, चाहे वो राज्य मानवाधिकार हो, उनके पास लाखों की संख्या से जो जो मामले दर्ज हुए उनकी तरफ इस मानव अधिकार ने सही तरीके से ध्यान दिया और अच्छी तरह से उन्हें न्याय देने का काम इस मानव अधिकार ने दिया है. 1993 के बाद आज इस संशोधन करते वक्त मैं धन्यवाद दूंगा इस अपने देश के गृह मंत्री जी अमित शाह जी को और माननीय गृह राज्य मंत्री जी को कि अब संशोधन करते वक्त इस मानव अधिकार की व्याप्ति कैसी बढ़ाई जा सकती है और ज्यादा से ज्यादा ये मामले दर्ज करने वाले को न्याय सही वक्त पे कैसे दे सकते हैं, इसकी अच्छी तरह से प्रावधान इस संशोधन विधेयक में की जा रहे हैं, ताकि पहले दो सदस्य के जगह पे तीन सदस्य बने चुके. एक आवश्यक था कि महिला सदस्य को नियुक्ति करने, इस महिला सदस्य की नियुक्ति करने का प्रावधान भी इस संशोधन विधेयक में की गए हैं, और साथ साथ में पांच वर्ष के जगह पे तीन वर्ष का अवधि इस विधेयक के माध्यम से सदस्य को दिया है. ये बहुत अच्छी संशोधन करते वक्त अच्छी बातें इसमें शामिल करने का प्रावधान इस विधेयक के माध्यम से हो रहा है. सभापति महोदय, अपने देश में, खास करके अपने देश में रहने वाले जो मानव है या जो लोग हैं, उनके अधिकारों का संरक्षण करना, उनके अधिकार का हनन न होना, इसके ऊपर ध्यान रखने का काम इस मानव अधिकार आयोग का होता है. लेकिन जैसे कि हमारे सत्यपाल जी ने कहा, उनके कई बातों से मैं सहमत हूँ. अपने लोकशाही का इतना नाजायज फायदा कई संगठन के माध्यम से कभी कभी होता है कि उनके लिए, यानी लोकशाही किसी के लिए है और मानव अधिकार किसके लिए स्थापन किया है, उसको पूरी तरह से भूल जाकर मुझे दुख हो रहा है कि जैसे कि सत्यपाल जी ने कहा मुंबई में आतंकवादी हमला हुआ 26/11 को 1993 में, उसमें कसाब जैसे भयानक आतंकवादी को पकड़ा, अभी तक 3 मिनट नहीं हुआ सभापति महोदय, कसाब जैसे भयानक आतंकवादी ने जैसे हेमंत करकरे जैसे बड़े पुलिस ऑफिसर को शहीद होना पड़ा उनके सामने, और ऐसे बड़े आतंकवादी को, खतरनाक आतंकवादी को मुंबई पुलिस ने जब हिरासत में लिया, जैसे तुकाराम मोमले भी शहीद हुए उसको पकड़ते वक्त, और ये कसाब को जब जेल में रखा गया तो उसे सोने के लिए बिस्तरा नहीं मिल रहा है, उसे मच्छरों के वजह से उसको तकलीफ हो रहा है, खाने के लिए बिरयानी नहीं मिल रहा है, इसके लिए मानव आयोग अधिकार के पास जाने वाले भी कई संगठन अपने देश में है, ये दुर्भाग्य की बात है। जैसे भी उन्होंने कहा ये सही बात है कि प्रदेश से मिलने वाले जो आर्थिक सहायता है वो उसका नाजायज फायदा उठाकर अपने देश में ये नाजायज एक्टिविटी करने वाले जो संगठन है उनके माध्यम से जो मामले मानवाधिकार के पास जाते हैं उनके तरफ ध्यान देने की आवश्यकता नहीं है। लेकिन
पिनाकी मिश्रा
लेकिन खास करके
पिनाकी मिश्रा प्लीज
सभापति संशोधन विधेयक की विशेषता एक है कि बालिका के ऊपर होने वाली जो
अत्याचार, वी हैव टू कंक्लूड द एंटायर डिस्कशन बाय 2 o'clock
शामिल किया है।
सॉरी
सर, लास्ट का आधा मिनट
पिनाकी मिश्रा प्लीज।
लेकिन मैं एक
नथिंग विल गो ऑन रिकॉर्ड प्लीज।
संशोधन विधेयक के ऊपर बात करते
3 o'clock
हिज माइक इज स्टिल ऑन।
आकर्षित करना चाहता हूं कि पिछले कई वर्षों से
एड्रेस चेयर ऑनरेबल मेंबर
ओके आधा मिनट
फिनिश
पिछले कई वर्षों से हिरासत में लिए जाने वाले जो कई गुनेगार हैं,
सारे गुनेगार आतंकवादी नहीं होते, लेकिन इस गुनेगार को उनके कई आत्महत्या करने की घटना हो रही है, कई जेल में उनकी मृत्यु होने की संख्या बढ़ती जा रही है, तो इसके तरफ भी सावधान से देखने की जरूरत है ताकि मानवाधिकार ने भी उसकी तरफ जांच करने की आवश्यकता है। फिर एक बार मैं इस बिल का समर्थन करता हूँ और मेरे विचार समाप्त करता हूँ। धन्यवाद।
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, sir, for having called upon the Biju Janata Dal to contribute in the deliberations on this bill. On the face of it, Mr. Chairman, sir, this bill has been brought about only to obviate some of the obvious difficulties being faced by the Commission, and therefore many of these are unexceptionable clauses which have sought to be amended or sought to be inserted. Some of my colleagues in the opposition ranks, I think, have had some misgivings about why the Chief Justice's position has been diluted to the judge's position, both in Supreme Court and High Court. They need have no such misgivings. As a matter of fact, in law, the Chief Justice is only the primus inter pares, which is first among equals. Otherwise, he's only the master of roles. Otherwise, all other powers of all judges are equal, so therefore it doesn't dilute the provision at all. In fact, most Chief Justices who retire nowadays are very much in demand as umpires in arbitration panels where there are 2 judges on either side. So therefore, Chief Justices obviously prefer. And I personally know of how many Chief Justices have said no to the National Human Rights Commission. So this is a practical difficulty. Therefore, there is no question of the government trying to dilute this. We understand that. Other provisions of addition of a lady member, that's obviously welcome, to include chairperson of the National Commission for Backward Classes, chairperson of the National Commission of Child Rights, disabilities as deemed members, also very salutary provision. Reducing it from 5 years to 3 years is also good because it doesn't then bind you down to spend too long a time. But really, Mr. Chairman, obviously none of these clauses can be taken exception to, so we support them. But the point is, there needs a slightly larger debate on the position of the National Human Rights Commission in India. What differentiates us from Pakistan, what differentiates us or distinguishes us from China, from Russia, from many of our neighboring countries, is the fact that we have such a bustling, such an importantly constitutionally valid National Human Rights Commission, which has always been exceptionally bullish in its outlook. That is, otherwise, the kind of reception we got in the International Court of Justice, where in the Kuldeep Jadhav case, where 15-1 almost the entire world, not almost, in fact, the entire world except Pakistan sided with us, is because they understand that we have such a sterling track record as far as the human rights issues are concerned. Therefore, it's very important that we don't dilute this commission over a period of time. There are certain misgivings I must point out. The sanction strength of this commission has been coming down from over a period of time. Even today, the investigating division has only 49. It's come down from 59. That's not a happy situation. In fact, since its inception, the commission has never had the full sanction strength as compared to the available strength. This is not a happy situation. The annual reports are routinely being filed with massive delays. In fact, today the latest available annual report is of 2015-16. So in 2019, if the 15-16 report is available, that's not a happy situation at all. This must be rectified. The Supreme Court has, in the extrajudicial execution victims families association matter, in fact, has called the NHRC essentially, to quote it, a toothless tiger. This is not a happy situation, again, because you will see that in many of these extradition claims which are being fought against us abroad, in courts abroad, the first ground that is taken to try and stall extradition is the human rights record of India is not a happy record. There is torture happening in India. There is illegal incarceration happening in India. So therefore, the moment we really buffer up our human rights position, we will get a much better picture internationally, and that is really what distinguishes India from the rest of the world. I have to also say, I don't know whether the rest of the house is with me on this, the bar of the armed forces, including the paramilitary forces, from being investigated directly by the Human Rights Commission is again not a happy situation. There is no difference in an extrajudicial killing, Chairman Sir, between when the police undertakes it or an armed force personnel undertakes it or a paramilitary forces undertakes it. There is no difference at all. So therefore, according to me, this is something that we must seriously look at, because the vast number of complaints which are coming are really coming on that count. The happy situation is that people obviously seem to have a great deal of faith in the commission, because the number of complaints which are filed on a daily basis apparently sometimes are exceeding 400, 500 complaints. So which means people truly have a great deal of faith in this commission. But for them to be dealt with efficaciously, Mr. Chairman, sir, we must staff the commission adequately. The government must pay adequate attention to this, because you see, the commission doesn't have binding force in terms of its diktat. So therefore, whatever it gives, even as a recommendatory exercise, I think will have great evidentiary and great value publicity-wise for the country. So it's in the nature interest of our country that all of us, on a bipartisan basis in this House, ask for burnishing the credentials of the Human Rights Commission. Thank you very much for allowing me
thank
to
you,
speak.
Thank you. Shrimi Supriya Sule.
Well, actually, I like to second even what my earlier two colleagues have said, be it Professor Roy, Pinaki Mishra and Kanimori, and hugely disappointed by the attitude of the Treasury bench. It's unfortunate that the Speaker is not here, but I'm deeply hurt and pained because I represent liberal India, and for them to challenge science, and there is a word called Shraddha in India and something called Andhashraddha. What the Honorable Treasury bench Speaker was talking about, Andhashraddha. Sir, you all know what has happened in India. You remember the Kalburgi, the Pansare, the Dabholkars of this country who were killed for liberal thinking. And then in this 21st century parliament, which is Sabka Sahat, Sabka Vikas and Sabka Vishwas. Now, if Human Rights Commission is only getting challenged and science is getting challenged, I don't know what Vikas and Vishwas is this government talking about. So I'm actually really surprised. And there are two points that he said about Manav Adhikar Sangathan. And he talked more about the NGOs. We are not discussing NGOs today. We are discussing what our rights are and what people want. Look at what Pinaki Mishra gave us data. 500 people go up to the commission every day. So this is not about what NGOs are doing outside. What common man feels today, the first step is to go to the police. If you don't get it, people go to judiciary. After that, they go to the Human Rights Commission to ask for some fairness. So I think the first point is that 1 year gap that they have given only, that the case has to be in 1 year, I think that needs to be extended. This is not about whether we should have, the whole world, we are looking for peace. and then you're challenging Human Rights Commission. It's just shocking and disappointing for me, actually. And this whole bill that we are discussing has to be gender neutral. It's not about just about women, children. And even the LGBT group, we passed the 377 bill here. Why are the LGBT not getting included in this? Because the challenges they have as human rights, because human rights is not only about terrorists or police. I mean, I'm disappointed that they gave a ex-police officer to discuss this, because the first reaction that everybody thinks is that the minute you talk about human rights, it has to be about some custodian killing or a terrorist. That's not what this case is about. It has various sections of society that are affected by human rights. So I think we even need to get the LGBT groups involved in this. There are a few recommendations I would like to make for suggestions that we need to do. Is we need to completely revamp this entire scheme that is. So I'm actually surprised that why are you bringing, the Honorable two MOSs are here, piece by piece, why are you bringing, why don't you revamp the whole thing in the larger interest of the nation if you're truly committed for it of equal rights. And we need more decision-making power. There is no decision-making power. And who are the people you ask when the commission, there is an inquiry, it's either the state government or the central government. So it's two arms actually of the same body that are question answering each other. So it may not be a fair trial. There has to be all the non-state actors and actors have to be given a voice here. So I completely, I'm actually surprised and disappointed with the speech, and I'm worried that is our freedom going to be taken away by this government? Because they seem to be completely against any voice that anybody raises. And I would like to take this opportunity to quote Martin Luther King. What he says is, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So if this government is so concerned about people raising voices, and I'd like to quote Soli Sorabji when he talked about this. He said, India's teasing illusion. So this is an illusion about human rights, and especially after hearing the speech of the Treasury bench, I'm actually devastated. It's unfortunate Sri Jaishankarji was not here to hear that speech. It would be as devastated, because I have so much faith. He's one of the few ministers I'm very hopeful about for a just and fair. And what is our leadership about? Leadership about honesty, it's about being fair, and it's about being just. And if the leader, Treasury benches, is only going to make allegations and say NGOs are doing this, rights are not about NGOs. It's about being fair, and it's about being just. Any injustice, a good governance is not just about criticizing somebody. It's about hearing the pain of your people and being fair to them and just to them. And I would request the entire Treasury benches that please don't write. Human rights are very important. It's a right that my constitution has given me. Nobody has taken. The entire freedom struggle that we all went through was built on honesty and freedom of speech and rights. So please don't write it off. Please bring this bill again. Let's have a more detailed discussion on it and increase the ambit of it so that it's strengthened, so no citizens of India ever goes without his issues unaddressed. Thank you, sir.
Honorable Sushil Kumar Singh.
धन्यवाद और आपके प्रति आभार कि आपने इस महत्वपूर्ण विधेयक पर बोलने का मुझे अवसर दिया है. सरकार ने मानवाधिकार संरक्षण विधेयक जो लोकसभा में लाया है उसके समर्थन में बोलने के लिए मैं खड़ा हुआ हूं. सभापति जी, मानव सृष्टि की सर्वश्रेष्ठ कृति है, ये माना गया है. और रामायण में एक चौपाई है, इसमें कहा गया है, बड़ा भाग मानुस्तन पावा, यदि मनुष्य के रूप में जन्म लेना ये अहोभाग्य है, ये सौभाग्य है. मनुष्य को की एक वृत्ति है, मनुष्य का एक स्वभाव है कि वो भूखा रह सकता है, लेकिन यदि उसके सम्मान पे ठेस पहुंचती है तो वो बड़ा दुखी होता है. हमारे संविधान में कानून के हिसाब से और उस दृष्टि से मानव के संरक्षण के लिए मानवाधिकार आयोग का गठन हुआ और कुछ मौलिक अधिकार भी की भी का भी प्रोविजन, उसका भी प्रावधान है हमारे संविधान में. इस विधेयक में कुछ प्रस्ताव लाए गए हैं, मैं इसका समर्थन तो करता ही हूं और कुछ व्यावहारिक बातें आपके माध्यम से मैं सरकार के सामने रखना चाहता हूं। ऐसा देखा गया है कि कई बार किसी व्यक्ति के साथ कोई अमानवीय घटना होती है, उसे किसी प्रकार से प्रताड़ित किया जाता है, टॉर्चर किया जाता है, तो वो कई दिनों तक अवसाद में चला जाता है, कभी कभी वो डिप्रेशन में चला जाता है। आदमी भूखा रह सकता है, एक दिन दो दिन वो भूखे रह के जिंदा हो सकता है, रह सकता है, लेकिन उसके सम्मान के साथ, उसके मानवाधिकारों के साथ जब हनन होता है तो वो आदमी बहुत दुखी हो जाता है। ऐसे कई उदाहरण हैं और इसके दोनों पक्ष हैं। कई बार ये भी होता है कि कुछ हमारे देश के अंदर तथाकथित स्वयंसेवी संगठन हैं, एनजीओज हैं, जो अनावश्यक रूप से चीज़ों को उछालते हैं और केवल अपनी पब्लिसिटी के लिए, सरकार को बदनाम करने के लिए ऐसी बातें उछालते भी हैं। वर्तमान में इसके अंदर जो प्रावधान किया गया है वो है, पहले इसमें जो प्रावधान थे उसमें यह था कि इसके अध्यक्ष के लिए माननीय सर्वोच्च न्यायालय का मुख्य न्यायाधीश होना आवश्यक था, लेकिन मैं इस प्रस्ताव का समर्थन करता हूं कि अब इसकी अनिवार्यता समाप्त कर दी गई है। यह बड़ा अच्छा है और स्वागत योग्य है। साथ साथ ये भी कहना चाहता हूं, अब ये हो सकता है कि सर्वोच्च न्यायालय के या किसी न्यायालय के दूसरे न्यायाधीश भी इसके सदस्य या अध्यक्ष हो सकते हैं, ये बहुत अच्छा है। लेकिन साथ साथ मैं सरकार को ये सुझाव देना चाहता हूँ आपके माध्यम से कि अभी एक सदस्य को इसमें और जोड़ने की जो व्यवस्था की जाने वाली है, ऐसे में इसके सदस्यों की संख्या 6 हो जाएगी। और कभी कभी ऐसी स्थिति उत्पन्न हो सकती है कि किसी गंभीर मसले पर मत विभाजन हो और 3 सदस्य इसके किसी बात के समर्थक हों और 3 इसके विरोध में हों, फिर वैसी स्थिति में अनिर्णय की स्थिति उत्पन्न हो जाएगी। तो मेरा सरकार से आपके माध्यम से यह कहना है, यह सुझाव होगा कि इस बॉडी की संख्या हमेशा ऑड नंबर में रखी जाए, ताकि मत विभाजन की स्थिति में 3-2 की संख्या हो या 4-3 की संख्या हो, वरना बराबर बराबर हो जाएगा तो अनिर्णय की स्थिति हो जाएगी। दूसरा, मैं ये कहना चाहूँगा कि इसमें इस आयोग को और शक्ति संपन्न करने की आवश्यकता है, इस आयोग को और अधिकार देने की आवश्यकता है, क्योंकि अभी तो मैंने शुरू ही किया है और मैं अपनी पार्टी का दूसरा स्पीकर हूँ, दूसरा वक्ता हूँ, इसलिए कृपया मुझे अपनी बात पूरी करने दिए सभापति जी, और मैं ज़्यादा देर तक बोलने वाला भी नहीं। मेरा ये कहना है कि इस आयोग को और शक्ति प्रदान करने की आवश्यकता है, क्योंकि माननीय सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने भी कहा है कि यह आयोग एक टूथलेस टाइगर है, यानी आयोग के पास वो शक्ति नहीं है कि अपने निर्णयों को वो लागू करा सके। तो फिर ऐसे में इस आयोग का बहुत ज़्यादा की सार्थकता नहीं रहती है। इसके अतिरिक्त ऐसा है कि मानवाधिकार हनन की घटनाएं बढ़ रही हैं, चाहेंगे तो मैं फिगर दे दूंगा। हमारे माननीय गृह राज्य मंत्री जी यहाँ उपस्थित हैं, जो बड़े ही संवेदनशील व्यक्ति हैं, कल ही इन्होंने बाढ़ पे तुरंत चर्चा शुरू हुई और तुरंत संज्ञान में लेते हुए अपना पक्ष भी रखा, जवाब भी दिया। तो इस तरह से एक संवेदनशील व्यक्ति और मंत्री के सामने यह चर्चा हो रही है। इसमें पहले इसमें कर्मचारियों की संख्या 59 था, जो घटकर 49 हो गया, जहां इसमें आने वाले मामलों की संख्या बढ़ रही है, लेकिन सदस्यों इसमें कर्मचारियों की संख्या घट गई।
प्लीज कंक्लूड।
मैं कंक्लूड कर रहा हूं। इसके एक सुझाव और देना चाहता हूं कि जिलों के स्तर पर मानवाधिकार न्यायालयों की स्थापना होनी चाहिए, क्योंकि मामले बहुत बढ़ रहे हैं, अभी 1,00,000 से ज़्यादा मामले पेंडिंग हैं, और जिला के स्तर पर, हमारे बिहार में तो राज्य के स्तर पर भी, बस खत्म ही कर रहा हूँ महोदय, हमारे बिहार में राज्य के स्तर पर भी अभी मानवाधिकार आयोग का न्यायालय नहीं गठित है। वैसे ये काम राज्य सरकार का है, लेकिन यहाँ से एडवाइजरी तो जाना ही चाहिए, यह मेरा एक सुझाव है। अंतिम बात महोदय, मुझे पूरी करने की अनुमति आप देंगे, मैं खत्म ही कर रहा हूँ। एक सेक्शन है 353, सरकारी काम में बाधा, ये आईपीसी का सेक्शन है, जो अंग्रेजों के ज़माने में ये कानून बना। उस समय देश गुलाम था, ब्रिटिशर्स रूल करते थे और हम भारतीयों पर वो शासन करते थे। अपनी सुविधा के अनुसार अंग्रेजों ने इस कानून को बनाया था, लेकिन ये कानून 2000 के पहले, सन 2006 के पहले तक ये कानून अवेलेबल था, जमानतीय धारा था। 2006 के बाद भारत सरकार ने इस कानून को गैर जमानतीय धारा बना दिया। मेरा आपसे, आपके माध्यम से ये कहना है कि हम राजनीतिज्ञ लोग हैं, सामाजिक राजनीतिक कार्यकर्ता हैं, या कोई आम आदमी है, किसी कार्यालय में अपने कार्यवश जाता है, उसका काम कई दिनों तक, महीनों बस खत्म, ये मेरा अंतिम है,
प्लीज कंक्लूड नाउ,
खत्म कर रहा हूँ मैं, निष्कर्ष पर आ रहा हूँ। कई दिनों तक, महीनों तक उसका काम नहीं होता है, वो कार्यालय में जाता है और कर्मी से या अधिकारी से अपनी बात कहता है कि मेरा काम क्यों नहीं हो रहा है। जरा सी कोई बात हुई नहीं कि सरकारी कर्मी उसके ऊपर एक मुकदमा लाद देते हैं। कोई नौजवान गया अपनी नौकरी के लिए, डोमिसाइल सर्टिफिकेट बनाना है, इनकम सर्टिफिकेट बनाना है या कास्ट सर्टिफिकेट लेना है, देर हो रही है तो वहाँ जमा करने की अंतिम तारीख होती है, इसके लिए वो जरा सा बात करता नहीं कि उसके ऊपर एक 353 का मुकदमा दर्ज कर दिया जाता है, और ये सेक्शन जो है 2006 के बाद नॉन अवेलेबल कर दिया गया।
प्लीज
मेरा आपके माध्यम, ये मानवाधिकार का एक हनन है, इसलिए मेरा आपके माध्यम से सरकार को ये आग्रह होगा कि यह जो विभिन्न, ये जो सेक्शन है आईपीसी का 353, इसको गैर जमानतीय से जमानतीय किया जाए, ताकि
कृपया नटराजन,
थैंक यू सर। द मोस्ट नोटेबल वीकनेस ऑफ द प्रोटेक्शन ऑफ ह्यूमन राइट्स एक्ट 1993 इज इट्स अ फेलियर टू चेक द एक्सेस ऑफ द पुलिस एंड आर्म्ड फोर्सेस एस्पेशली इन कश्मीर एंड नॉर्थ ईस्टर्न स्टेट्स। क्लास 9 ऑफ द एक्ट 1993 द प्रोसीजर विद रेस्पेक्ट द आर्म्ड फोर्सेस एज ओनली प्रोविजन्स ऑफ recommendations against the gross human rights violation of the armed forces in these states. Further, in Delhi, Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram and Nagaland are some of the states which do not have a human rights commission even after 26 years of the passing of the Protection of Human Rights Act in 1993. Basic human rights were being ignored in the name of national security in these states. In this area, the Armed Forces, the Special Power Act 1958, AIFSPA, gives Armed Forces unlimited powers with impunity in the name of national security. Jammu and Kashmir tops in the list. Human rights violation committed under AIFSPA with 92 complaints and with Indian Army and paramilitary forces in 2016. Assam comes in second with 58 complaints. Manipur comes with the third, 21 complaints, which Meghalaya and Arunachal Pradesh follow the next 5 and 6 complaints respectively. Of the 186 complaints received, 74 were against the Indian Army. Death in army encounters saw 24 complaints, death in army firings saw 16 complaints, while there were 21 cases of alleged fake encounters and 10 cases of rape and abduction. On 14th July 2017, in a breakthrough judgment, the Supreme Court for the first time took 1,528 cases of fake encounters under AIFSPA in Manipur, ordering a Central Bureau of Investigation probe into 97 of them. Alleged incidents of ongoing human rights violation and sexual abuse by the armed forces had forced the Supreme Court to question the army whether it has rapist in uniform. The 16-year-old hunger strike by Irom Sharmila. Everybody knows about the case. I don't want to mention more. So the Human Rights Commission, the proposed amendments to the Human Rights Act, I don't agree with this. I request the government to withdraw all this. Don't try to dilute the act. The second point is, I request the government, I am concluding my speech by registering my strong opposition to the laxity of the Protection of Human Rights Amendment Bill 2019 and urge the government to adhere to the international principles and standards on human rights. Thank you.
Thank you. Sri Jayadeer Galla.
Thank you, sir. Sir, it's very happy to be speaking today with Minister of State Sri Kishan Reddy Garu also here. I think he was here, just left, my Telugu brother. And also Sri Nityanand Rai Ji, who was my benchmate in the 16th Lok Sabha. So I'm very happy to be speaking. Also, our Honorable Home Minister, Sri Amit Shah Ji, is present here today. So I'm very happy to be speaking on this bill. Sir, I rise to support the bill. And I agree with the statement of the Honorable Minister on the statement of objects and reasons that there are problems in getting chairpersons to head the state human rights commissions. It is because the 1993 Act made it compulsory to make the Chief Justice or High Court of the High Court the chairperson of the SHRCs. Now this bill removes that, and henceforth any judge can become the chairperson. In my opinion, it's a welcome move. Sir, the position of chairperson and members of the AP State Human Rights Commission are lying vacant. There is not even an administrative officer in this commission, sir, in Andhra Pradesh. States such as Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, Manipur, Meghalaya, Himachal Pradesh, Orissa, and Maharashtra are also having no chairpersons for the State Human Rights Commission. This clearly indicates the state of affairs, and I hope that this bill paves the way for full-fledged SHRCs in all the states very soon. Sir, we have to agree that human rights violations in the country are continuing in an unabated manner. They vary from arbitrary killings, forced disappearance, arbitrary arrest and detention, torture in police custody, lack of criminal investigations or accountability in cases such as rape, domestic violence, dowry-related deaths, and honor killings, just to mention a few. Even if one looks at the country report on human rights practices for 2018, the State Department of the United States said that the government of India is imposing restrictions even on censorship, using libel laws to prosecute social speech and site blocking in 2018. The issue of human rights also plays an important role when foreign investors come to India. So in a way, human rights violations also impact our growth trajectory. So this also has to be kept in mind. Sir, we have been discussing various forms of human rights violations, but I strongly feel that one such act that needs to be immediately addressed is the act of manual scavenging, which is a flagrant violation of human rights. There are studies which reveal that manual scavenging is even associated with caste-based discrimination. It is a violation of Article 252, which prohibits manual scavenging. Article 16, the right to equality. It is also in violation of Articles 3, 5, 7, 8, and 12 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Article 2, bracket 1 of the International Labour Declaration of Human Rights, of Fundamental Conventions and Forced Labour Conventions. This indicates that we have enough legislative backing, but we do not have the will to stop this brazen human rights violation. I think even the Prime Minister has spoken on this, and I urge the House through you, sir, and the government to please look into this and how to remove manual scavenging. Sir, one more very important issue. Even after the Supreme Court declared privacy as a fundamental right, the government, through Aadhaar and other bills, is somehow still trying to encroach on that right. I had also raised this many times in the House about one particular notification issued by the Home Ministry on 20th December 2018, authorizing 10 central agencies to intercept, monitor, and decrypt any information generated, transmitted, received, or stored in any computer without any authorization. This also, in my opinion, constitutes a human rights violation. It's not acceptable, and this should be stopped. I'm just concluding, sir. The Human Development Index of 2016 places India at 131st place out of 188 countries, behind South Asian countries like Sri Lanka and the Maldives also. This needs to be improved, and I assure the Honorable Minister that we are with you when you take steps to protect human rights of our citizens. Sir, nobody in this House wants India to be projected as a human rights violator, but it is the government of the day which has to take steps to improve the status of India in the comity of nations as far as human rights is concerned. With these observations, I conclude my speech. Thank you, sir.